Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Bee Season, written and narrated by Myla Goldberg. This work is copyrighted 2000 by Myla Goldberg. This recording is copyrighted 2001 by Recorded Books. Bee Season begins with two quotations. The world of letters is the true world of bliss. Abraham Abulafia. Are you really proud of me? Rebecca Silfon, 1997 National Spelling Bee Champion. And now, Bee Season.
At precisely 11 a.m., every teacher in every classroom at McKinley Elementary School tells their students to stand. The enthusiasm of the collective chair scrape that follows rates somewhere between mandatory school assembly and head lice inspection. This is especially the case in Ms. Bürgermeier's 4th-5th combination, which everybody knows is where the unimpressive 5th graders are put. Eliza Naumann certainly knows this. Since being designated 3 years ago as a student from whom great things should not be expected, she has grown inured to the sun-bleached posters of puppies and kittens hanging from ropes and trying to climb ladders and wearing hats that are too big for them above captions like, "Hang in there," "If at first you don't succeed," and "There's always time to grow." These baby animals, which have adorned the walls of every one of her classrooms from 3rd grade onward, have watched over untold years of C students who never get picked for Student of the Week, 6th place winners who never get a ribbon, and short, pigeon-toed girls who never get chased by boys at recess. As Eliza stands with the rest of her class, she has already prepared herself for the inevitable descent back into her chair. She has no reason to expect that the outcome of this, her first spelling bee, will differ from the outcome of any other school event seemingly designed to confirm, display, or amplify her mediocrity. Ms. Bürgermeier's voice as she offers up spelling words matches the sodden texture of the classroom's cinder block walls. Eliza expects to be able to poke her finger into the walls, is surprised to find she cannot. She can certainly poke her way through and past her teacher's voice, finds this preferable to being dragged down by its waterlogged cadences, the voice of a middle-aged woman who has resigned herself to student rosters filled with America's future insurance salesmen, Amway dealers, and dissatisfied housewives. Eliza only half listens as Bürgermeier works her way down the rows of seats. In smarter classrooms, chairbacks are free from petrified bubblegum. Smooth desktops are unmarred by pencil tips, compass points, and scissors blades. Eliza suspects that the school's disfigured desks and chairs are shunted into classrooms like hers at the end of every quarter, seems to remember a smattering of pristine desks disappearing from her classrooms over spring and winter breaks to be replaced by their older, uglier cousins. Bürgermeier is 10 chairs away. Melanie Turpin, who has a brother or sister in every grade in the primary wing, sits down after spelling tomero, which even Eliza knows is spelled with an O. Eliza also knows that lizard is supposed to have a Z, and that personnel needs a second N. And suddenly the B gets more interesting, because Eliza is spelling all the words right, so that when Ms. Bürgermeier gives Eliza raspberry, she stands a little straighter, proudly including the P before moving on to the B-E-R-R-Y. By the time Bürgermeier has worked her way through the class to the end of the first round, Eliza is one of the few left standing. 3 years before Eliza's first brush with competitive spelling, she is a 2nd grader in Ms. Ladowski's class, a room that is baby animal poster free. Eliza's school universe is still an unvariegated whole. The wheat has yet to be culled from the chaff and given nicer desks. There is only one curriculum, one kind of student, one handwriting worksheet occupying every desk in Eliza's class. Though some students finish faster than others, Eliza doesn't notice this, couldn't tell if asked where she falls within the worksheet completion continuum. Eliza is having a hard time with cursive capital Q, which does not look Q-like at all. She is also distracted by the fact that people have been getting called out of the classroom all morning and that it doesn't seem to be for something bad. For one thing, the list is alphabetical. Jared Montgomery has just been called, which means that if Eliza's name is going to be called, it has got to be soon. The day has become an interminable duck-duck-goose game in which she has only one chance to be picked. She senses it is very important that this happen, has felt this certainty in her stomach since Ladowski started on K. Eliza assures herself that as soon as she gets called out, her stomach will stop churning, she will stop sweating, and cursive capital Q will start looking like a letter instead of like the number 2. Ms. Ladowski knows that second grade is a very special time. Under her discerning eye, the small lumps of clay that are her students are pressed into the first mold of their young lives. A lapsed classics graduate student, Ms. Ladowski is thrilled that her teaching career has cast her in the role of the Fates. Though she couldn't have known it at the time, her abbreviated classical pursuits equipped her for her life's calling as overseer of McKinley Elementary's Talented and Gifted, or TAG, placement program. Ms. Ladowski's home, shared with a canary named Minerva, is filled with photo albums in which she has tracked her TAG students through high school honors and into college. In a few more years, the first of her former charges will fulfill destinies shaped by her guiding hand. Ms. Ladowski prides herself upon her powers of discernment. She considers class participation, homework, and test performance, as well as general personality and behavior in separating superior students from merely satisfactory ones. The night before the big day, she goes down her class roster with a red pencil. As she circles each name, her voice whispers, "Tag, you're it!" with childlike glee. Stephen Sills spells weird with the I before the E. Eliza spells it with the E before the I and is the last left standing. As she surveys the tops of the heads of her seated classmates, she thinks, "So this is what it's like to be tall." She gets to miss fifth period math. Under Dr. Morris's watchful eye, she files into the school cafeteria with the winners from the other classes and takes her place in a plastic bucket seat. The seats are shaped in such a way as to promote loss of circulation after more than 10 minutes. Two holes in each chair press circles into the flesh of each small backside, leaving marks long after the sitter has risen. Each chair has uneven legs, the row stretching across the stage like a hobbled centipede. Through the windows on the left wall, buses arrive with the PM kindergartners. In the kitchen, hundreds of lunch trays are being washed. From behind the closed kitchen comes the soothing sound of summer rain. Eliza feels a sudden pang of guilt for having left a lump of powdered mashed potato in the oval indentation of her tray instead of scraping it into the trash, worries that the water won't be strong enough to overcome her lunchtime inertia. Dr. Morris is the kind of principal who stands outside his office to say goodbye to students by name as they scramble to their buses. Administering the school spelling bee allows him the great pleasure of observing his best and brightest. The children before him are the ones whose names adorn the honor roll. They are names teachers track long after having taught them in order to say, "This one was my favorite," or, "I always knew this one would go far." Eliza is the exception to this rule. When Dr. Morris spots her in the group, he is reminded of something he can't quite place. At his puzzled smile, she blushes and looks away. The meeting between Dr. Morris and Eliza's father, that Dr. Morris can't quite remember, occurs on Parents' Night, 1 month after Ms. Ladowski goes from Kathy Myers to John Nervish, skipping Eliza. Saul Naumann only learns of his daughter's exclusion through one of his congregants, who, after Shabbat services, announces loudly enough for the people on the other side of the cookie table to overhear that her son has been identified as talented and gifted. Saul realizes that the boy is in Eliza's class. Eliza hasn't tendered Saul the congratulatory note Aaron delivered at her age, the one that made Saul feel like a sweepstakes winner. Saul's is one of many hands Dr. Morris shakes that parents' night. Dr. Morris's office contains a desk with a framed picture of his daughter, two squeaky chairs, and a window that looks out onto the school playground. On a small bookshelf, binders of county educational code bookend with instructional paperbacks devoted to several categories of child, including special needs, precocious, problem, and hyperactive. Dr. Morris keeps mimeographed pages from these books on hand to distribute to the parentally challenged. "Hello, Mr. Naumann. It's a pleasure to see you here tonight." Dr. Morris remembers the son. Smart, awkward, too quiet for his own good. While he knows the daughter's face, he can't attach words to the picture. He scans her file, hoping for help and finding nothing. "Eliza is a lovely child." "Thank you. We think she's pretty special, which is why I was a little surprised when I learned that she hadn't been tag-tested with the rest of her class." Morris manages a polite smile. Every year, there is at least one like Mr. Naumann. "Well, Mr. Naumann, that's a bit of an exaggeration. Only a portion of the second grade is tested. The fraction of the class Miss Ladowski feels may benefit from an accelerated curriculum."
"The smarter ones?"
"There are a lot of different kinds of smarts, Mr. Naumann. A lot of ways for a child to be special." Dr. Morris addresses that last part to the picture on his desk. It's too bad Saul can't see this picture from where he's standing. If he could see it, he might conclude that this is a somewhat sensitive topic for Dr. Morris. The only people who generally get to see Rebecca Morris's picture are the students Dr. Morris catches using the word retard. He escorts these students to his office, where they are shown the picture and ordered to repeat the word, this time to his daughter's face.
"Of course there are a lot of ways to be special," Saul continues, no way to know that he really shouldn't. "But my older son was placed in the TAB program, and I just thought that..."
Dr. Morris's face has grown red.
"Instead of focusing on what you think you lack, Mr. Naumann, why don't you appreciate what you have? Eliza is a caring, loving child."
"Of course she is. That's not the issue."
Dr. Morris pictures Rebecca walking unsteadily to the van that comes for her each morning, the beatific smile that fills her face at the sight of any animal, and her pleasure at a yellow apple cut into bite-sized pieces. He wants Mr. Naumann to get the hell out of his office.
"So sorry, Mr. Naumann, but our time is up. I wouldn't want to keep the other parents waiting. But..."
"Goodbye, Mr. Naumann. A pleasure seeing you again." From third grade onward, Eliza's class is divided into math and reading groups. Eliza's reading group is called the Race Cars. She likes it okay until she learns that the other reading group is called the Rockets. The Rockets read from a paperback that has "The Great Books" printed on its cover in gallant letters. When she asks Jared Montgomery what's inside, he tells her that his group is reading excerpts from The Canon, and Eliza feels too stupid to ask if that means something other than a large gun. She can't help but wonder if someone told her which books were great and which ones were just so-so, if she'd like reading more. While she eventually adjusts to the faded motivational posters featuring long-dead baby animals and the 50-era reading books whose soporific effects have intensified with each decade of use, she can't get it out of her head that while she is speeding around in circles waiting to be told when to stop, other kids are flying to the moon. Within half an hour, all the fourth graders have been eliminated except for Lee Chan, who never washes his hair and outlasts two fifth graders and a sixth grader from the fifth-sixth combination. When Lee finally misspells follicle, the eliminated fourth graders chant, "Stink bomb," until Dr. Morris blinks the lights to quiet things down. Eliza gets canary, secretary, and placebo. By the time ceremonial and probability come around, it is down to her, Brad Fry, and Cinna Bagaduri. Everyone knows that Cinna is the smartest girl in school and that Brad is the smartest boy, but probably not as smart as Cinna. If anyone knows Eliza, it is from breaking the school limbo record, which got her name on the music classroom blackboard for a few weeks, but which always goes to the short kids anyway. Cinna has blue contact lenses and big boobs. Everyone knows her eyes are fake because they were brown the year before, but Cinna insists that a lot of people's eyes change when they go through puberty. Brad plays soccer at recess and has a lot of moles. There are rumors that he spends his summers at a camp for kids who take math and science classes because they want to, but Brad tells everyone he goes to soccer camp. No one believes him either. A couple times when it's Eliza's turn, Cinna starts toward the podium and Dr. Morris has to remind her to wait. Waiting for Cinna to return to her seat, Eliza pretends she is a TV star during opening credits, her face caught in freeze frame. She imagines her name appearing below her face in bold, white letters. Cinna spells imminent without the second M. She is already walking back to her seat when Dr. Morris says, "I'm afraid that's incorrect." It gets very quiet, like at the beginning of a blackout before anyone has thought to fetch a flashlight. Cinna walks off stage, biting her lower lip. Brad is next, but he is so surprised by Cinna getting out that he has to ask for possibility three times before he spells it with one S. Despite his assertions to the contrary, he also believes that Cinna is the smarter one. Which just leaves Eliza, who spells correspondence with her eyes closed to avoid looking at three rows of students staring at her in disbelief. In Eliza's fantasy, she walks to the podium, which she is suddenly tall enough to see over, and begins speaking to a cafeteria suddenly filled to capacity. "A few of you might know my name, but most of you don't even recognize me. I know you, though. And what I'm about to say is as important to you as it is to me." It's the lead-in to a speech from a particularly powerful after-school special. Eliza's always thought it made a great beginning. No actual words come after that, but Eliza's mouth keeps moving and the music swells. By the end, all the students are smiling with little tears in their eyes, and Lindsay Halpern makes a place for Eliza at her table between her and Roger Pond. Eliza stands outside Saul's closed study door, an envelope hot in her hand. She's not sure this is a valid interruption. She's not sick. Nothing's on fire, and the District B isn't until the weekend. But if she waits for her father to come out so she can hand it to him, it might be another 2 hours. Eliza considers waiting anyway. Perhaps her father will need to use the bathroom, or maybe he'll get hungry for a snack. She puts her ear against the door, but hears nothing. When she looks down, she finds that her hands have unconsciously reopened the envelope and removed the letter. A few words are smeared now. The paper's creases are fuzzed with wear. Eliza realizes for the first time that her last name is misspelled. She feels a sudden urge to tear the letter, burn it to ash, cram it down the disposal. Instead, she folds the letter back into thirds, licks the by-now-dissolved adhesive on the envelope's flap, and shoves the letter through the crack beneath her father's study door. Saul's study is smaller than Eliza's bedroom in that it lacks a closet, making it the smallest room in the house, not counting bathrooms. Its perceived dimensions are diminished further by the bookshelves lining its walls and piles of notes in various stages of collapse layering the floor. Notebooks of various thicknesses and binding methods protrude above the thinner strata like stepping stones. The average paper density increases toward Saul's desk, which emerges from the tumult like a piece of flotsam tossed by the paper tide. Saul's desk spares no room for distracting doohickey or clever calendar, covered as it is by books and notes, loose and bound. On the wall directly above the desk, framed pictures of Mordecai M. Kaplan and Gershom Scholem provide inspiration. A small desk lamp serves as one of only two light sources, both unnatural. The room's lack of windows is for the best, since the bookshelves leave no room for them. In this room governed by disorder, the shelves are the exception to the entropic rule. Saul's library is arranged alphabetically, recent paperbacks brushing spines with age-seasoned, leather-bound volumes. English texts adjoin Hebrew and Yiddish. In Saul's decision to mix languages, he has accorded privilege to a letter's pronunciation over its ordinal placement. Thus, Hebrew writer Shmuel Yosef Agnon is in among the A's, alongside Aaron Appelfeld, even though the noblest's last name begins with an ayin and the novelist's name begins with an aleph. While the library's overall organization might cause many a self-respecting academic to blush, to Saul, the study is a paper-lined nursery in which his scholarly interests may grow and blossom by the light of 280-watt soft white bulbs. When Saul closes the study door behind him, he closes the book of the everyday world as well, placing it upon a distant shelf until familial duty or emergency calls him back. So it comes as no surprise that he doesn't hear the quiet foosh of Eliza's envelope. Unnoticed, it joins the morass of paper carpeting the floor of his study, invisible to anyone who doesn't know to look. Saul Naumann spends the first portion of his life as Sal Naumann, son of Henry and Lisa Naumann, decorator of Christmas trees and Easter eggs. Henry has every expectation that his only child will follow him into the car repair business. From an early age, Saul has been replacing spark plugs and changing oil. Though he dislikes the combined smells of car exhaust and sweat, the hardness of the garage floor, and the mess of wires and cold metal that compose the machines of his father's fancy, Saul fosters these associations for the sake of the rare smiles proffered by his father in their company. Saul is 13 when his mother takes him into the attic and shows him the box. There is a photo of a bearded man with long side locks and a black hat, his hand on the shoulder of a boy. At first, Saul cannot believe that the curly-haired boy with the fringes hanging past his shirt is his father, Heimel Naumann, the bearded man his grandfather Yehuda. Saul learns the word orthodox. His mother shows him a pair of brass candlesticks and a wine cup. She describes a world ruled by the book, a world with little room for change. She relates eloping with Heimel after Yehuda declared her not Jewish enough. Saul sees his birth certificate and learns of his father's decision to renounce the faith, the shift from Heimel to Henry and Naumann to Naumann occurring after Yehuda ignored Saul's birth. Saul, who had been named for Yehuda's brother Solomon in one son's attempt to regain a father's love, became Sal. It is Lisa who sneaks her son books, occasionally taking Saul to a nearby synagogue on Henry's Friday nights out. It is their secret until Henry comes home unexpectedly one evening to find them lighting Shabbat candles. From that point onward, Saul insists on being called by his given name. By Saul's sophomore year of high school, he has given up any pretense of interest in cars, and his father has given up interest in him. When Lisa dies of cancer, the house becomes a lonely and divided place, the last link between father and son turning to dust in a box underground. The fights begin soon after, never violent, but increasingly damaging. Saul's escape to a liberal arts college finalizes the rift. When Saul uses his student status to stay out of Vietnam, Henry officially washes his hands of his ungrateful hippie Jew of a son. Saul discovers LSD and Jewish mysticism at the same time, a chance concurrence that strengthens the validity of both. During his acid trips, Saul experiences the same sense of time displacement and receptivity described in the texts. On one occasion, he attests to having ascended through several levels of being in a manner similar to the ancient mystics, who rode a chariot through six castles on six celestial realms to reach God at the seventh heaven. Saul becomes a campus celebrity and preferred LSD guide. At the end of his undergraduate career, and with the war still on, it is only natural that he enter rabbinical school. Saul enters Baruch Yeshiva on scholarship. His scholarship is revoked during his freshman year when, in the name of mental exploration, he convinces his roommate to place a tab on his tongue, and the resultant bad trip leads to said roommate painting his naked body blue and white and running into the dean's office to declare himself the new Israeli prime minister. Saul returns to his alma mater to live rent-free in the attic of an off-campus house inhabited by undergraduates who know him by reputation alone. The attic is charred from a semi-recent fire, contains no electrical outlets, and is uninsulated. Saul can stand fully erect as long as he keeps to the room's center. He illuminates the space with chains of Christmas lights running off an extension cord snaked up the narrow attic stairs from a lower-floor bedroom. Saul spends his time in the library, studying Jewish thought and history in a rigorous, self-styled curriculum that surpasses his academic efforts at any time during his official enrollment. He regularly attends religious services and adult education classes at a nearby synagogue. Alone in his attic, Saul practices the traditional songs and fantasizes about someday leading a congregation, if not as a rabbi, then as a cantor. There are drawbacks to this scavenged existence. While Saul has ample access to drugs and female undergrads in his capacity as sexual and psychoactive guide to the student body, the role has begun to wear thin. His acid trips are too déjà vu. He has worn deep grooves in the psychedelic path, falling into the same hallucinatory and revelatory ruts time after time. Increasingly, his affairs with women remind him of his age and the fact that he hadn't pictured himself at 23 making love to clumsy teenage co-eds on a dirty twin mattress in a burnt-out attic. Increasingly, Saul finds himself fantasizing about his own study, a job that gives him time to pursue his interests, and the prospect of children with whom he can share his hard-won life lessons. On Friday nights, Eliza sits with her brother in the first row of the Beth Amicha synagogue. While Aaron recites the responsive prayers without glancing at his prayer book, Eliza focuses on a spot on the bima between Rabbi Meyer and her father and tries to block out the robotic monotone of the congregation reading as one. It reminds her too much of aquarium fish, the mechanical open and shut of their mouths as they stare blankly through the glass. While the congregation drones on, Eliza turns her attention to the brown-flecked linoleum floor tiles and thinks of the biblical exodus from Egypt. She transforms each fleck into a Jew in a wind-swept robe, trekking 40 years across the desert to reach the promised land. She imagines blisters from uncomfortable sandals. She pictures a tribe of Charlton Hestons looking righteous and bearded and sun-creased. Her reverie is interrupted by Rabbi Meyer's voice telling the congregation to rise, which she manages to do fast enough to hide the fact that, moments ago, the floor had been the Sinai. Rabbi Meyer is a tree trunk of a man with a broad forehead and bushy eyebrows that have gone gray, even though the rest of his hair remains dark. He looks out at the congregation through disproportionately small eyes, which he has willed down in size to take in as little of the world as necessary. Beth Amicha would not have been his preference, but he was Beth Amicha's rabbi of choice. With suburban rabbis outnumbering suburban synagogues 2-1, Oro Meyer chose a steady salary over spiritual affinity. A conservative Jew, Meyer disapproves of Beth Amicha's laxer reform tendencies. He had initially hoped to spur the congregation to new heights of observance, but Saturday evenings, when he lights the braided Havdalah candle and watches the shadows flicker upon the synagogue's walls, he is often alone. Beth Amicha tends to regard Shabbat as a Friday night obligation. Most congregants have never been to a Havdalah service, have never heard the crisp ksh of the Havdalah flame being quenched by the wine, the true moment of Sabbath's end. Rabbi Meyer longs to lead a congregation that appreciates this sound. But a good rabbinate is hard to find. He comforts himself with the fact that his is not the life of the itinerant rabbi, reduced to performing the brises, weddings, and bar mitzvahs of strangers. Saul's gangly arms look particularly cartoony when he leads prayers on his guitar, strumming and even thumping as he sings. On the Judaism spectrum, Saul's self-proclaimed Reconstructionism puts him left of center, an affiliation the congregation hoped would counterbalance Rabbi Meyer's, leaving Beth Amicha's services somewhere in the middle. By playing the strict traditionalist, Rabbi Meyer makes the congregants feel as if they are being the type of Jew of whom their parents would approve. By playing his guitar and turning prayers into group sing-alongs, Saul allows people to have enough fun to forget they've come largely out of guilt. Rabbi Meyer is the dentist, Saul the congregation's lollipop reward for having kept their appointment. English prayers outnumber Hebrew ones. The Jewish Congregational Prayer Book attempts to compensate for this by using thou and thee instead of you, and by adding est to verb endings. Mayest thou liest down and risest up is supposed to feel more like the 4,000-year-old language the book has largely replaced. There is, of course, some Hebrew. A gifted minority can parse the words without any idea of their meaning. For those who forgot Hebrew phonetics soon after depositing their bar mitzvah checks, there are English transliterations. The foreword to the JCP claims that the transliterations are for the reader's ease and comfort. This gentle lie cloaks an embittered editor's elaborate scheme to avenge the childhood he suffered while actually learning the language. SH replaces T. A K is inserted where a G would be more appropriate. As a result, it is painfully apparent who is reading the Hebrew and who is not. Misbegotten syllables collide mid-air with their proper cousins, making the service more closely resemble a speech therapy class than a religious gathering. Aaron will recite the Hebrew just a little faster than everyone else, just to show that he can. He doesn't need to actually look at the JCP. He can recite the entire service beginning to end with his eyes shut. Since he was 8, people have been saying he should be a rabbi. Aaron is embarrassed by how much he still likes to hear this. Walking through the synagogue doors, he imagines heads turning to look, excited whispers of, "There goes the cantor's son." Inside Beth Amicha's walls, he is junior class president, football captain, and star of the school musical. In Aaron's imaginary congregational yearbook, he is most popular and most likely to succeed, with the special added superlative of best young Jew. In Beth Amicha, he's pretty sure girls smile at him sometimes. He never doubts his clothes. He is neither too tall nor too pale. Eliza can't read Hebrew like her brother. In the time it takes her to negotiate the first 5 words, picking her way right to left across the page, the prayer is halfway over. Rather than add to the aural melee, she chooses to keep her mouth shut. For years after his summary dismissal from Dr. Morris's office, Saul entertains hopes that Eliza will prove her elementary school principal wrong. Grading quarter after grading quarter, he erases all memory of report cards passed, tearing open each successive manila envelope in a frightful evocation of predator and prey. Eliza is sitting at the kitchen table, so engrossed in a taxi rerun that a mini pretzel is frozen in its trajectory from the bag to her mouth. The sealed manila envelope rests on the table just beyond the pretzel bag's shadow. Jim Ignatowski and Alex Rieger are far more comforting than the sound of Saul exiting his study. Eliza can block out the sounds of her father's arrival altogether if she concentrates very hard on the openings and closings of Alex Rieger's bloodless mouth. Eliza is 7. She is 9. She is 6.5. She is any age at all between second grade and the present. Jim Ignatowski is bugging his eyes out at Latka Gravis, that funny little foreigner, and Eliza is right there in the taxi depot with them, can practically smell Louis' cigar as he barks commands from the dispatch desk, wants to bury her face in Latka's grease-stained overalls. Her father's hand snaps her out of it. Eliza wishes her father's hand were on her shoulder for some other reason, generally covets all forms of his attention. She feigns absorption in the TV so that the hand will stay a little longer. Eliza has learned this trick from Saul himself, though she knows his powers of concentration are real. Take, for example, the time the ambulance came for Mrs. Feruza when she broke her hip. The sound of passing sirens shook the walls, but Saul swears he didn't hear a thing, reading as he was a recent translation of Pico della Mirandola. Eliza isn't convinced her father would hear an emergency knock on his closed study door. What if she was bleeding, choking, going blind, the house burning down, the escaped convict holding her at knife point? She has been kept awake nights wondering if her father would save her in time. The hand on her shoulder is gone. The manila envelope, now empty, has fallen to the floor. Eliza cannot help but watch her father's eyes scan the twin grade columns. She feels compelled to watch his face fade from expectation to resignation. Math, C. Science, C. Social studies, C. Work habits, B. Behavior, A. Reading, B. Spelling, A. Then, the forced smile, the patting of the head, the click of Saul's door after his silent retreat to his study always manages to cut through the sound of the television. That night, when Eliza glides into sleep, she sees the disappointment on her father's face behind her closed lids. Eliza realizes too late that slipping the spelling bee notice under her father's door may have been a mistake. There is no historical reason for her father to think that an envelope from her is a good thing. When that first day he emerges from his office without lauding her bee victory, Eliza assumes he has saved the envelope's opening for a better mood. She decides to keep quiet, to preserve the surprise. She likes picturing Saul's face the moment he realizes the envelope's true contents, mentally screens and rescreens this imagined moment to ease her anxiety. When 3 days pass without a word, Eliza, so accustomed to being disappointing, begins to wonder if the singularity of this, her first achievement, has caused her to overinflate its importance. Spelling, after all, is a skill made redundant by the dictionary. The steady stream of spelling A's on her report card has never inspired much praise. Perhaps her father is even a little embarrassed? That all his daughter can do is spell? His daughter, who still can't recite the Hebrew alphabet? Eliza accepts this possibility with the inherent grace of the acutely underconfident, decides not to mention it until he does. By Friday night, Eliza's resolve has been seriously shaken. The District B is less than 24 hours away. Even if her father is not impressed by her victory, he should have acknowledged by now that there are transportation needs to be met. Saul has never shirked his duty as child chauffeur, is a reliable member of any carpool. But by now, Eliza cannot imagine bringing it up. Like many things left unsaid, Eliza's thoughts have metastasized, kernels of doubt exploding into deadly certainties. She has taken Saul's silence to mean that her accidental achievement is too little, too late. Friday night after services, she cannot sleep. She stays in bed until she can't stand picturing another version of Dr. Morris's rebuke for her failure to serve as the school's spelling representative. It's way past midnight. Eliza decides to visit her mother in the kitchen. Miriam Naumann is a hummingbird in human form, her wings too fast to be seen without a stop-motion camera. The silver in her hair makes her seem electric, her head a nest of metal wires extending through her body. Eliza can only imagine the supercharged brain that resides inside, generally equates the inside of her mother's head with the grand finale of a July 4th fireworks display. The fact that Miriam only needs a nightly 3 hours of sleep helps to foster this mental image. Saul has calculated, with some envy, that his wife's Spartan sleep requirements gain her 2.5 months more wakefulness than the average person annually. Eliza has never seen her mother's law office, but is certain that it is kept as obsessively clean as the kitchen. Counters are waxed daily, as is the floor. The dishware in the cabinets is arranged according to precise plan, the stacks spaced exact distances apart and ordered according to a conception of size, color, and function that no one but Miriam fully understands. Miriam refuses to waste anything and insists upon maximum space conservation, such that a spectrum of containers is needed to house everything from the single remaining meatball to the half bowl of uneaten salad. The Tupperware she uses toward this end, stored in cabinets under the oven, is a vision of military precision. Miriam cleans at night. She is working the formica in her favorite rubber gloves when Eliza sits at the kitchen table. The room is silent, except for the tick of the oven clock and the smoosh, smoosh of the green side of Miriam's Scotch-Brite scrubber sponge pad. Eliza knows she could sit here for an hour without attracting her mother's notice. In a concentration contest, Miriam would pin Saul to the mat every time.
Mom?
Miriam looks up mid-stroke.
Ellie, when did you wander in?
Just a few seconds ago. I can't sleep.
Miriam works the counter like she's massaging sore muscles. She is at her most placid in the morning's small hours. Eliza used to fake insomnia for the chance to stay up with her, a ruse Miriam became expert at detecting. For Eliza, the smell of solvent conjures up rival feelings of love and frustration.
Are Saul and Aaron asleep?
In Miriam's conversations with her children, Saul has always been Saul and never father. It is a habit of speech to which Eliza, after 11 years, still hasn't adjusted. Saul's name in her mother's mouth makes Eliza feel as if her father is not actually hers, just some man who has come to live with them.
Yeah, they're asleep.
Miriam flips the cleaning pad from green to yellow, downshifting from scrubber to sponge. The counter gleams like an ice rink post-Zamboni. Eliza had originally intended to tell her mother about the bee, but something about the way Miriam is scrubbing makes Eliza fear that her words will be washed away upon leaving her lips. Eliza has a growing suspicion that she never won the bee at all. Her father's silence proof that she has imagined everything. Eliza decides to keep quiet. If the bee isn't real, she would like to hold on to its illusion a little longer. Miriam turns her attention to the refrigerator. She removes a jar of gherkins, a bottle of Worcestershire, and a tub of margarine, wiping each with a handy wipe before lining them precisely along the line in the linoleum floor tile pattern. The fridge light bathes Miriam and the foodstuffs in a soft yellow glow. Though Eliza cannot identify the song's title, she finds herself mentally humming the opening bars of the Pachelbel canon, the image of her mother at the fridge having tapped into a memory of the music from a light bulb commercial. Mom? Miriam jerks her head like someone caught sleeping in class.
Silly me! Forgot you were here!
Miriam offers Eliza the jar.
Would you like a gherkin?
Miriam is the only one who actually eats the gherkins, drinking the juice from the jar when she's through.
No thanks. I've been wondering, do you clean so much because you like to, or because you have to in order to get to sleep?
The light from the refrigerator turns Miriam's silver hairs to gold. The Worcestershire has been placed in the exact center of the middle shelf of the refrigerator door. A pint of strawberries has taken its place on the floor between the pickles and the parquet. Miriam knits her eyebrows together until they resemble a hairy rendering of a bird in flight. Eliza isn't sure her mother has heard her question. When Eliza looks into Miriam's eyes, she sees vast intelligence and unspannable distance. Miriam is born to wealthy parents for whom parenthood equals patriotism. Melvin and Ruth Grossman's desire for a large, boisterous family a la Kennedy is tempered with each of Ruth's miscarriages into steely determination. Some of Ruth's near pregnancies are cruel in their duration, allowing for hopes to be raised and names to be chosen before the painful end. This only intensifies the couple's fervency. After 4 childless years of marriage, Ruth and Mel have become procreative partisans in the clash between will and womb. Ruth's ultimate pregnancy and delivery of a baby girl is a battle won, but a war lost. Miriam's difficult birth leaves Ruth unable to bear more children. Accordingly, Miriam becomes the repository for the expectations Mel and Ruth harbored for all 5 of their conceptual offspring. These quintupled aspirations trickle down to Miriam through a series of high-powered nannies and tutors, money no object in ensuring that their sole surviving progeny receives the best of everything 5 times over. Miriam is an exceptional and obsessive child. She forbids anyone to touch her toys and insists upon her underwear being washed twice before it's returned to the bureau drawer. Mel and Ruth interpret their daughter's eccentricity as a sign of genius, insist she be humored to facilitate her intellectual growth. Miriam learns the extent of her social maladjustment upon her enrollment at a prestigious boarding school at age 12. There, her natural predilection for study is reinforced by the unremitting mockery of her peers, the library quickly becoming her only place of refuge outside the classroom. She is a phenomenal student. In college, her powers of concentration achieve mythic status when she is evacuated from the stacks by a fireman who discovers her intent upon a book despite the blaring alarm that has cleared everyone else from the building. Miriam and Saul meet when she is finishing law school and he is working as a research assistant for a Judaism professor. Saul has abandoned drugs to devote himself to a life of mystical scholarship. He now knows that LSD was a false doorway, a simulation of an experience accessible only after years of devoted study. He looks upon his acid insights as shadowy imposters, clay pigeons that will explode at the first touch of true transcendence. Though he knows he may never share the experience of the ancient mystics, Saul has decided to spend the rest of his life trying. Miriam embodies the intellectual discipline Saul senses he will need to reach his goal. Her unconventional mannerisms seem charming indicators of her rich mental life. He is attracted by her permanent slouch, her head always slightly craned forward, as if examining a book's fine print. He likes the solidity of her body, neither fat nor thin, which she carries with a charming lack of self-awareness. As their acquaintance deepens, the hidden workings of Miriam's mind beckon to Saul like a seven-veiled Salome. Their early courtship consists of shared dinners in the campus cafeteria, followed by neighboring seats at lectures with titles like God and the Plague, Religious Revivalism in the Middle Ages, and Unmaking Your Mind, Discerning Truth from Falsehood in the Midst of Vietnam. Saul thrills to Miriam's intellectual veracity, attends the lectures solely to observe her assiduity as she drinks in the words. Weeks later, she can alternately defend or destroy the lecturer's arguments point by point without having taken any notes. Until law school, Miriam's entire academic career is single-sexed, boys an elective she bypasses. Though she has been on a few abortive dates, Saul is the first beau willing to indulge her interests, the first not to suggest popcorn and a formulaic comedy followed by an invitation to his apartment. Saul's experiences with the greater portion of the female student body at his alma mater have taught him to be a good listener. With Miriam, he is patient, luring her with his constancy. Miriam is grateful for the attention. Aware that her unique temperament might severely limit her relationship options, she had been willing to take on someone far more socially stunted than Saul. Though not religious, Miriam takes self-congratulatory pride in dating a Jew, on occasion even accompanying Saul to synagogue for the opportunity to analyze group religious ritual. Into their third week of dating, Miriam scrutinizes the library's dog-eared Joy of Sex and Height Report from the relative privacy of her cubicle. Sex, like ironing or changing a flat tire, is an essential life skill to be mastered. She is intrigued by a first-hand account of an orgasm as a giant body wave. And so, after a month of twice-weekly dinner lecture dates, Miriam and Saul make love. It is the longest Saul has waited to bed a woman he is wooing. While Miriam harbors unspoken reservations, she still prefers to wash her underwear twice and is well-versed in the number of microorganisms exchanged during a kiss, she is intrigued by Saul's vast sexual experience and knows he represents her best chance at a good lay. Miriam is glad they go to his apartment. While somewhat willing to yield up her body, she is less certain about her sheets and towels. Though Saul wants to undress his new lover himself, Miriam insists upon removing her own clothes, standing with her back to Saul, two-fold blouse and slacks, placing each neatly on a chair before proceeding. Saul marvels at Miriam's softness, at the woman inside the scholar. He loves her small breasts and wide hips, takes to calling her his hidden pear, a pet name that makes Miriam blush, but which she secretly enjoys. Miriam is intrigued by the spareness of Saul's body. She is grateful for the opportunity to examine his angles, his long limbs and fingers, this her first object lesson in male anatomy. Miriam's shyness at her own nakedness momentarily disappears with the novelty of his. She's more interested in Saul's scrotum than his penis, fascinated by the way its skin undulates at her slightest touch, how it shrinks with the cold and Saul's increasing arousal, relaxing into a loose purse after making love, when it has soaked up the warmth of the sheets and their bodies. The two bond over their mutual lack of family ties. Saul, from his disownment, Miriam, from the car accident that orphaned her as a college junior. Both want children. Miriam has inherited her parents' idea of procreative legitimacy, wants to compensate for her only childdom. She sees in Saul the house husband who will enable her parental ambitions without disabling her autonomy. In Miriam, Saul sees the means to a book-lined study and a lifestyle conducive to mystical advancement. They are both absolutely certain these things equal love. When Eliza knocks on her brother's door Saturday morning, he is trying to abstract the reflection of his chest in the mirror. If he can pretend that his chest belongs to a stranger, he may be able to judge it objectively rather than through ugly colored glasses. His sister's knock sparks a comprehensive blush, the pale skin from forehead to stomach turning shades of sunburn. Aaron hesitates before opening the door. To shirt or not to shirt? He and Eliza used to see each other topless all the time. That was before being 6 years apart meant anything, when their small, pale chests were indistinguishable in the tree-strewn sunlight of the backyard. It was before Aaron had learned that a small, pale chest can be a liability, that 6 years apart is an expanding universe with a brother at one end and a sister at the other. But Aaron wants to play shirts against skins without chickening out if he's picked for the wrong team. He wants to feel comfortable in just his bathing trunks. He decides he'd better answer the door the way he is. Shirtless, Aaron looks even more breakable than usual, as if caught in an act better accomplished from within a cocoon. A thin vein descends the left side of his neck and across the skin of his upper chest like a crack in a window pane. Eliza tries not to act surprised at the sight of it. Though she hasn't given Aaron's chest much thought, she assumed it still looked the same as the last time she saw it, which, now that she thinks about it, was a really long time ago. Since then, her brother's nipples have grown. There are curly black hairs. The hairs are sparse and thin, as if sapped by their struggle to grow so dark from such pale skin. Aaron's chest hairs call to mind other body hairs, hairs that make Eliza decidedly uncomfortable. She shifts her focus to her brother's face. When she looks up, however, she realizes that Aaron has been watching her watching his chest. She looks down again, this time at his feet, which she notices are also hairy.
I was wondering if you could drive me somewhere?
Eliza says to the tuft below the first knuckle of her brother's leftmost toe. Years and years before hairs and spelling bees, Aaron drives Eliza places all the time. Their two modes of transport are the living room couch and the fallen down tree in the backyard, one for when it's raining and the other for when it's not. While both agree that the log is better for making their destinations feel more authentic, Eliza has a special fondness for the couch, where she can sit beside and not behind her brother, taking head-on the dangers that come their way. And there are always dangers. In addition to being navigator, Eliza is official spotter of the alien monsters and sea squids and pumas with which they regularly engage in furious and bloody battle. Eliza likes letting her brother lead the attacks. Aaron knows all the secret moves of the ninja and Jedi, and has even taught her a few. Eliza takes for granted her brother's availability for these and other games, has no cause to question his lack of additional playmates, ones perhaps a little closer to him in age. It is Aaron to whom Eliza turns after a bad dream has scared her awake, the warmth of his bed assurance that she will be protected should her nightcrawlers return. Eliza's first day of kindergarten, Aaron pilots her through the doors of McKinley Elementary with sixth grade flair. He points out office, cafeteria, and library, describes a secret shortcut to the playground swings, and explains the trick to evading as long as possible the teacher's end-of-recess whistle. Eliza starts kindergarten assured that her 6 years older brother has vanquished all school-born monsters, squids, or pumas. Aaron, who can take Eliza to Neptune or to the bottom of the ocean. Aaron, who can impale an attacking mastodon with one hand while fending off a Cro-Magnon with the other. Aaron, whose sister's gilded image of him will last 4 more months before the real world strips it of him. Since Aaron earned his license, no one has asked him for a ride anywhere. This is probably for the best, as Aaron is an extremely anxious driver, viewing the car as of himself and, therefore, open to attack at any moment. Another person in the car might send his wariness into overdrive. "If Dad won't take you, then he probably won't let me take you either," Aaron responds to his sister's request. Aaron started talking softly so long ago that he has forgotten it was originally a conscious choice. Though Eliza has grown used to it, she can remember running through the backyard armed with thwacking sticks while Aaron screamed, "Beware, space demon, for it is I, Captain A, who have come to blast you into the 13th galaxy." Aaron feels too weird being in front of Eliza without a shirt, but putting one on now might only draw attention to the fact that he was shirtless before. Besides, he really wants to be able to walk around for hours naked from the waist up, even outdoors, and not think about it. "You're not listening," Eliza complains, tossing a sock in Aaron's general direction but hitting him in the left nipple, an unintentional bullseye. "The bee is in Norristown this afternoon. I need a ride." Aaron opts for a shirt after all. "What bee?" asks the blue pocket tee being pulled over his head. Eliza is grateful for the clothing choice. T-shirted, Aaron seems less like a flipbook construction. Bird head, man body, goat legs, and more like her brother again. "I told you already, the district bee." "Don't you have to win your school bee or something to be in that?" Aaron's voice is a little louder now that his nipples are hidden. Eliza rolls her eyes and smiles. "God, Ellie, how did you do that?" Her face falls. "I mean, God, Ellie, that's great." "I guess." Eliza's voice has become as soft as her brother's. "No, really." Aaron puts his hand on Eliza's shoulder. He's really, really glad he decided on the shirt. "I'm totally impressed. I bet Dad's in Dad heaven. He loves that stuff." Eliza gives a small shrug and realizes she's about to cry. She decides it's time to talk about the envelope. Eliza follows Aaron downstairs to their father's study. Even though the door is open, Eliza feels odd stepping over the threshold. She envies the ease with which Aaron enters, as if Saul's study were just another room. The room is dark except for a circle of yellow light over Saul's desk, which illumines an airborne sea of dust. Saul is engrossed in a leather-bound book with stiff pages that, when turned, creak like old bones. "Hey, Dad?" Aaron's voice is swallowed up by the dust born of innumerable book pages and spines. To Eliza, the air itself seems heavy with knowledge. Aaron tries again, this time louder. Eliza recognizes her mother in the way Saul suddenly turns his head toward the sound.
"Hello, Aaron. I was just reading about the mystics' migration to Israel. Of course, it wasn't officially Israel yet, but..."
"Dad, did you get an envelope from Ellie this week?" At first, Saul's eyes are blank, as if not even his daughter's name holds meaning.
"Envelope? Was I supposed to receive an envelope?"
Eliza feels her stomach tighten and realizes she is unable to speak. With her eyes, she implores Aaron to continue.
"Ellie says she won the spelling bee."
Saul's face lights up.
"Why, that's wonderful, the class B. You know, when I was 13...
"No, Dad." Eliza's voice is impatient.
"Not just the class B, the school B."
Eliza watches the dust ride the currents of her breath.
"Well, that's just..."
Saul looks at Eliza as if she has suddenly borne a delicious fruit from her navel.
"This is quite a surprise."
"But I already told you. You've known all week." Eliza spits the words.
"And you haven't said anything."
She feels the pressure of tears against her eyeballs, but forbids herself to cry.
"Eliza, Ellie Belly, I didn't know. How could I have known? When did you tell me?"
Eliza's face is pink.
"The envelope. I put it under your door on Monday."
The room is silent. For the first time, Eliza notices the papers that cover the floor like snowfall. Saul grins.
"Then it must be down here somewhere."
Saul, Aaron, and Eliza sort through the drifts of paper. It is Aaron who finds the envelope, smudged from Eliza's hands and taped where she had torn it.
"Is this it?"
For a split second, Eliza pictures opening the envelope and finding nothing there, the letter having been absorbed into the dense piles of paper around it. She stifles the urge to snatch the envelope from her brother. Aaron realizes that his standing mental image of Eliza is 3 years out of date. In his mind, she is still a shy second grader, quietly insistent upon matching her socks with her shirt every morning. He wonders when she started parting her hair on the left, and if she's always had the nervous habit of sucking in her cheeks. The way Saul reaches for the envelope reminds Eliza of first-time Torah bearers, stiff-armed with their fear of mishandling the sacred burden. She likes that he uses a letter opener instead of his fingers. The smile that appears momentarily erases years of report card trauma.
"This," Saul says in a reverent voice, "is a beautiful thing."
Eliza is halfway through kindergarten when she sees her brother get beat up. What was thought to be a drill has, with the arrival of the McKinley Fire Department, been elevated to the level of a small, real fire. Though the tray of chicken fingers was extinguished long ago, certain protocols need to be followed, granting the students at McKinley a spontaneous recess while the fire department goes through the mandated motions. Eliza, as an AM kindergartner, was not expecting to experience recess until first grade and feels particularly lucky to have been given a sneak preview. Eliza is waiting her turn at the swings. She is fifth in line, but the bong, bong, bong of the alarm has been off for a while now. The firemen are returning to their trucks, and she is beginning to doubt that she will get a turn before everyone is sent back to class. She decides to abandon the line to investigate the noises coming from behind the line of evergreen bushes across the grass. She thinks it may be Holly Ermeline and Gina Girardi, whom she thought she heard talking about collecting red berries from the bushes in order to paint their fingernails, which Eliza thinks is a pretty stupid idea since she's heard that the berries are poisonous. Even though she doesn't really like Holly or Gina, she should at least tell them to wash their hands when they're done. As Eliza nears the bushes, she realizes there is too much sound and movement to be Gina and Holly. In fact, she gets a sort of sick feeling in her stomach that tells her she probably doesn't want to get any closer to the bushes at all. But it's the kind of feeling that also tells her in a soft, persuasive voice to keep going. The same instinct that guides young, naive hands to the pretty red stove burner, even though they've been told it is very, very hot. Eliza can make out two figures standing over a third. Eliza's first thought is, dog. She's seen boys throwing stones at a stray that hangs around the school. The dog, named Sucker by the stone throwers, slams into trees in its frightened attempts to get away, but is always there the following morning, waiting for the next cycle of torment to begin. Eliza bristles at the thought of the dog being caught, momentarily forgets her size and age, and ups her pace to the bushes, ready to battle even Marvin Bussy for the sake of Sucker's protection. She is steps away from the bush when she sees a flash of skin and realizes that what she thought was a dog is not a dog, despite the whimpering sounds. She is close enough now to recognize the two standing figures as Marvin Bussy and Billy Mamula. They call themselves the BM team, which Eliza thinks is really gross, but which Aaron tells her just confirms their place in the world as pieces of shit, which is the only time Eliza has ever heard her brother swear. Like most of the school, Eliza fears Marvin and Billy, but being both younger and a girl places her low enough on the elementary school food chain to allow her to call them names behind their backs. Eliza's willingness to face a conceptual Marvin Bussy evaporates at the prospect of encountering the actual one, even though she knows she'd have to do something really bad to get him to pick on a kindergartner. She has never witnessed Marvin's malice firsthand. His cruelty, like sex, is something she has only heard about, something that only happens in places she doesn't go. Eliza is staring at the scene a few seconds before she realizes that the thing that is not a dog looks a lot like her brother. Aaron has a shirt like the torn one of the boy on the ground. Aaron has skin that would contrast that disturbingly with the deep brown dirt. Marvin and Billy, backs turned and engrossed in what they are doing, haven't noticed her, but there is a sickening moment of clarity when Eliza realizes that the boy who almost looks like Aaron has been watching her the whole time. His eyes, wide with fear, are the exact shape of Sucker's when the dog is running in a blind panic, slamming into trees to the sound of jeering children. For what seems like years, Eliza stands staring. Almost Aaron's face remains frozen, not once leaving Eliza's, his body passively accepting its punishment. It is as if, having been thrown from a window, he has realized that relaxing every muscle will reduce the damage upon his inevitable impact with the ground. Marvin and Billy can't afford witnesses to such a suspendable offense. Eliza could call out for Gina and Holly, pretending she is just nearing the bushes to look for them. Marvin and Billy would be forced to stop, and the poor boy would be saved. Eliza mentally loops the scenario, looking for flaws and finding none. It would work. Bestial joy beams off Marvin and Billy like cold light. Eliza is mesmerized by the incongruity of action and reaction, reluctant to relinquish her stolen glimpse of such rare animals. Ultimately, however, her inaction is spurred by the revulsion that sweeps through her at the sight of the boy on the ground. His absolute stillness, his silence, his wide-open eyes. Even a half-blind stray dog would be struggling. Even Sucker wouldn't lie there, soundlessly accepting his fate. If Eliza intervenes, she will have to touch her almost brother. He will need help getting up. And there's no way she'd be able to help this boy, who can't possibly be Aaron. Aaron, who knows all the secret moves of the ninja and Jedi, Aaron, who saves Eliza from bad dreams. Aaron, who would never allow himself to be reduced to this. Eliza will never mention that Marvin and Billy are grinding berries and evergreen needles into almost Aaron's chest, laughing that they are curing his paleness once and for all, or that pricks of blood from the evergreen needles are indistinguishable from lumps of berry pulp on his almost skin. Eliza doesn't know what her almost brother is thinking as, without a word, she returns to the swings, stubbornly facing away from the bushes until the whistle blows and she returns inside without looking back.
The calm voice of the school nurse.
Your son has had an accident. He says he's all right, but he needs a change of clothes. Could you please come in?
Evokes Norman Rockwellian images of mud puddles and torn pants. When Saul arrives at the school to find a pale, marble statue of a son with a bandaged chest, he demands answers.
What the hell happened here?
He growls at the nurse, face red, eyes bulging.
I fell, Aaron says, too soft for anyone to hear.
He says he fell, says the nurse, who is constructed like a high school gym.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.